So the catenaries are twin cables that are approximately 10 feet apart and span 4,000 feet across the Glacier Creek. The catenary is put in the summer after the power line is completed because five towers were wiped out in Glacier Creek.
When making the video, stranded at Powerline Pass, I chatted with Scott Flavelle about the history of avalanches and avalanche mitigation along the power line from Kemano to Kitimat. Here are key parts of that conversation. Scott, why was the power line built and what was the terrain like?
Well, the main reason was to build an aluminum smelter on the coast of British Columbia, where electricity would be cheap and it would employ lots of people in the northern sector. The first studies were done in the 20s and 30s as to acquiring or reversing the flow of a river to get that power. And it was finally completed in 1954. So the lake system's now called the Nechaco Reservoir, and the water flows out of the lake for about 20 kilometers to Kemano and through penstocks to make the power. Now, from Kemano, there's an 82-kilometer power line that goes along more or less a sea level valley and then up over a 5,000-foot pass down into another sea level valley called Kildala, and then up over a tree-line pass and down into Kitimat. There's hundreds of towers along the way. There's two twin circuits or twin power lines. So that's three wires on each set of towers. And that was completed the very first year in order to have a backup circuit in case the first one failed. For making the aluminum, if the power ever fails, then the aluminum sets up in the pots and becomes a hard material that needs to be chipped out by jackhammer. So it's imperative that the power is continuous from Kemano over to Kitimat.
Were the avalanche paths recognized in the early days?
So in the research I've done, going back into the early days, one would think that the avalanche paths are somewhat obvious given all the slide alder and the lack of trees on the steep hillsides. However, nothing I read ever mentioned avalanches until the very first winter of operation when five towers were wiped out in Glacier Creek by avalanches. And somehow that only disrupted the power for 7 days. And somehow the men got back in there from Kemano and patched together the wires that were then only 12 feet above the ground on one circuit.
Why was the first catenary constructed for the power line? And what does a catenary look like?
The catenary spanned Glacier Creek Valley in order to eliminate five towers. So the catenaries are twin cables that are approximately 10 feet apart and span 4,000 feet across the Glacier Creek. It's a phenomenal feat of engineering to get this catenary put in place. The two cables that are spanning the valley are, if I had to guess, it'd be 1.5 to 2-inch cables. And then that means four major anchor points up on the steep alpine side hills. So all this work was done by helicopter. So it'd be drilling, concrete, etc. Where the cables cross the valley at the lowest point where the electricity cables are hanging, it's approximately 500 feet above the ground. So in the 80s or 90s, there is an aluminum helipad bolted onto the catenary where the helicopter would land and the linesman would get out to work on the insulators. So one of my projects I got involved with was, what happens if the helicopter can't come back? Can we rappel off? And so this is a big idea. I had to go and practice what the best way to have beginner rappellers rappel 500 feet directly down to the valley would be. And I figured it out and demonstrated it while they all had lunch over on the mountain and nobody wanted to try.
What was your involvement? Who were the other avalanche forecasters or technicians?
My first involvement with Alcan started in January 1993 after a tower 113R was destroyed by an avalanche in late December of 92. I got a call from either Colin Zacharias or the company that we work for called Gravitech. So Colin and I were their first avalanche technicians. And we were responsible for the safety of the men while rebuilding Tower 113 So January and February were of 93 were spent putting up a new collapsible and temporary tower, which then was destroyed the next winter of 1994. And so there's another rebuilding attempt going on, which was going to take even longer because they were going back to a lattice frame steel tower, which was being flown in by sections by helicopters. The first thing that needs to be done when the linesmen arrive on scene is to ground the conductor. And even though the power is shut off, they're collecting static electricity. And when I one time when I saw the conductor ground disconnected by about 10 centimeters, there's blue arcing sparks just from the static electricity. So it was enough to kill somebody. So it's super dangerous, and they have a special tool to connect it to the ground. Anyhow, once that's done, then they can start clearing the wreckage of the old tower, and then they need to prepare the foundations for the new tower. In terms of worker safety, of course, there's an avalanche safety program, including explosives, proper clothing, avalanche forecasting, when to be on site, when not to be on site. But one of the bigger risks was simply access. The access is all by helicopter. One would not want to spend the night up there. You're in an avalanche bowl. Sure, we had a plywood shack just to get out of the elements in order to have coffee and smokes. There was one escape route, which would be to head uphill approximately 1,000 feet to the pass proper, where there was a big shack with an old 1955 cat in it, as well as a kind of a weather station house that could be used for emergency purposes. But it's quite a long ways with people who don't really walk that much. So really, it was a very committing spot. And as you can imagine, the weather on the north coast is not generally that good. In the winter of 1994, Chris Stethem and Associates had the contract. And Hector MacKenzie, Herb Luer, and myself were the three rotating technicians.
Apart from the operational management of avalanche risk to the workers and towers, can you outline some of the avalanche history and planning for destructive avalanches?
I delved into the library at Kitimat and went back through all the records I could find. And at that time, got Chris Stethem and Associates involved, and we then made an avalanche atlas and then a risk matrix to all the various towers. The risk matrix is essentially built upon prior work of Dr. Marcel de Quervin and Peter Scheer, who had also rated the avalanche risk to the towers starting in 1960. So we just continue to build on this information, because now imagine in the late 90s, now there's much more concern about safety to the avalanche workers. And so it was kind of a combination of which towers were at the highest risk and which towers would be the most difficult to rebuild in a winter scenario with avalanches. In the research I'd done, it was 1973 where the first recorded dry snow avalanche in Twin Bowls destroyed Tower 105. And that time, De Quervin came over again and proposed a steel deflector. Later on, in 1985, another big dry avalanche destroyed Tower 124. And that's when Peter Scheer got involved. And then again, there's another large dry snow avalanche in 1992, and then 93 again. So I was quite fascinated by the placement of all the towers, because as an avalanche professional, I was always curious where the avalanches might run and which towers it might hit first. And when you realize the conductors and the towers need to go from high point of ground to high point of ground, then one would think that you could automatically avoid a lot of the avalanche terrain by just putting the towers on the high ground. But it turns out in the valley bottoms, the high grounds are all alluvial fans, and the highest part of the fan is right at the mouth of the looming gully. So I think that's why De Quervin had recognized that these lower elevation wet avalanches would affect the towers. So in other words, they had a different problem in all the valleys. They could still have avalanches, but they weren't of an alpine nature. Now, in the alpine terrain, there's less obvious high points to put the towers, and they were utilized whenever possible. but the spans are generally not that far, and so there's not that many convenient high points across the terrain. So some of the towers are put just on large open hillsides or bowls or alpine slopes.
Some towers were later protected from avalanches by splitters that reduced avalanche impact on the towers. However, splitters or deflectors weren't the solution for all exposed towers. This book explains how catenaries across the valley can hold up the conductors so there would be fewer towers and avalanche paths.
The first catenary was built in the summer of 1955. A second catenary was built in 2008. Several catenaries were proposed in the decades preceding, and then this was finally built after Tower 113 was destroyed twice by avalanches.
Finally, Tower 113R was no longer exposed to avalanches because it had been replaced by the second catenary. I'll put references to some related documents in the show notes. Thanks to Scott Flavelle for the remarkable story of destructive avalanches and avalanche mitigation along the power line from Kemano to Kitimat. For some background on Scott Flavelle, follow the QR code.